views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Hello and welcome to Leaders of the Future, a program produced by Niña de la Caridad Foundation and BronxNet TV. My name is Luis.
And my name is Fatima. LOTF is a youth-led program by young people, for young people, to inspire, motivate, and educate.
This episode, we are discussing technology in the Bronx. So stay tuned. This is Leaders of the Future. Welcome to Leaders of the Future. Today, we're discussing technology in the Bronx.
Technology has evolved over the years, becoming a human need for everyday life as opposed to a privilege.
Many people in the Bronx have been affected by the lack of access to technology. As students, we have faced many barriers, especially during the pandemic.
To address the digital divide that has increased in our community, Niña de la Caridad Foundation recently partnered with Hispanic Star and TechFin to hold a laptop distribution event. Let's check it out.
Like my son, especially now after remote learning, you know, they have to use computers or laptop or iPads. So my son is really going to appreciate this. He's going to the fifth grade, so it's going to be very helpful.
¿Qué se siente tener una computadora portátil por la compañía TechFin?
Emocionante.
¿Me puede decir por qué está emocionada de recibirla?
Estoy estudiando comercio, me gusta todo lo que tiene que ver con las redes, como la decoración. Quiero estudiar inglés por línea y ahora esto es fantástico para mí.
TechFin is an acronym for Technology for Families in Need. We partner with organizations like Hispanic Star, who are based in the community and are in a better position than we are to determine appropriate recipients for the machines that we source secondhand from corporations who no longer need them. So it's a way of narrowing the digital divide in a way that is green and sustainable. One of our slogans is we're redirecting machines from the scrap heap to the living room. A computer is as vital today as a refrigerator, in our opinion. It can help someone to get through school, take online classes, look for a job, excel at anything that requires information, which nowadays is just about everything. We firmly believe that the digital divide is there in part because of the cost of computer hardware.
Would you please tell us how you feel about having a computer at home and how it can advance people's knowledges about health?
That is very good. Well, I cannot work without a computer, first of all. A computer has all the information you need, and you learn a lot. I actually learn from reading books, but at the same time, the computer has tons of books that you can read, tons of information that you can find everywhere. It's very handy, and it's also very, very important for your health. There's a lot of doctors that use it to tell patients to go in and look for things. We have to know where to look for it, right? But it's a very good resource, and also research. You can find, you know, the data that we have right now, we're talking about like COVID, or we're talking about hypertension, we're talking about mental health, right? We don't have enough providers, let's say, for mental health, right? So now we're creating these new ways of doctors and providers, mental health providers, to communicate with patients. So if you don't have a computer at home, you can use it on your cell phone, but if you have a computer at home and you don't have a smartphone, it helps a lot. All these parents went through a lot of hardship during COVID, and this is just a great opportunity for them to succeed. As mom said here, she's going to use it to start studying, instead of starting English, to use it as a business also. And I know most of the parents that are here are in much need of a computer.
Yes, this will really help a lot of people. We've heard a bunch of stories today of different people that have different needs, and you might not know it on your daily basis, but some people really need laptops and computer desks at home.
Yes. Yeah, there's so many stories that you hear out there. You wouldn't think that at this day and age, somebody doesn't have some sort of electronic device, right? And yes, we've heard already some stories today of people that don't have any resources, that don't have, you know, computers for their kids that have special needs that can't go to the school. So I'm very happy that we were able to get this amazing donation from this great partnership that we have now. So thank you, Hispanic Star at Tech FIN.
Thank you for staying with us here on Lead Us to the Future. This episode is about technology in the Bronx.
Did you know a group of people came together to help address the lack of access to technology and digital divide in the Bronx?
This group is called the Bronx Digital Equity Coalition, and they helped bring a Bronx Gigabit Center to the community.
The center will offer free public Wi-Fi access through the Link New York City network, along with digital literacy training, free access to laptops and workstations, and other services.
Let's check out this interview we had with the Bronx Digital Equity Coalition.
The Bronx Community Foundation is the first of its kind in the borough. The Bronx is the only borough that hasn't had a community foundation. And basically, it is a foundation to support Bronxites in eliminating poverty, increasing wealth, and really coming together to think about what we need to do to build our community. It's also a space that provides resources. We've provided resources throughout the pandemic to small businesses, supported food pantries, the pop-up fridges. And so we're excited about this next leg of the journey for the Bronx Community Foundation as we really evolve into who we need to be for this borough. Right now, about 40% of Bronxites don't have today, right? Like as we leverage and manage devices from here to here, about 40% of Bronxites don't have high quality internet in their homes, nor the devices that they need. And so the Bronx is not where it should be. And we want to, at the foundation and in partnership with the Digital Equity Coalition, we want to eliminate that. So there are over 70 partners that are part of the Bronx Digital Equity Coalition. And the coalition came together really because, you know, when the pandemic hit, we all went into our houses and we had to learn remotely, we had to live remotely, we had to communicate remotely. And what we knew already, even before the pandemic, was that access to high-speed internet, access to quality devices, was not where it should be in the Bronx. And the Digital Equity Coalition really grew out of wanting to ensure that every Bronxite, every young person, every family member in the Bronx had access to high-quality internet and the high-quality devices that go along with them. Making sure our community members have access is not any longer a privilege, it's a right, it's a quality of life issue. The Bronx Gigabit Center is, first, it's a partnership between the city, ZenFi, to actually bring in high-speed internet access into this building. It is an amazing resource for our community. The Andrew Friedman Home, Mid-Bronx Senior Citizens Council, who've built this amazing space. But over the summer, we're gonna be offering some sample programming that we want to invite community members to come in to help us decide and guide what program will look like. So more to come, but we definitely want to invite people in and help us really reimagine tech equity for the borough. And it's actually a physical space where there will be just different kinds of programs. First, the Bronx Community Foundation is happy to have sponsored over 30 laptops to outfit the center. But in addition to that, there's gonna be music tech programs, art tech programs, coding programs. The Knowledge House is one of the partners who's helping to work on the program along with the rest of the coalition. And so it is a space to learn, leverage, use technology, expand your knowledge of how to leverage technology beyond, you know, just surfing the internet and the social ways we engage, but to really build, create, design. It's going to be all of those things. And this is such a beautiful space to house it. It would look like access. It would look like access. It would look like, you know, I know we're here at the Gigabit Center today. We're the home of, the ultimate home of the Gigabit Center. But it would look like every single household in the Bronx having access to high quality internet, high speed internet devices in their homes, from their devices, in their school buildings, in their office spaces, in grocery stores, in the bodega, in the laundromat. While you're doing laundry, you have access to internet so you can keep learning, right? You know, I remember when I was a young person that had to go to the laundry, I took a book with me. Well, young people today are taking their tablets with them so they can stay connected to either learning, or older adults are taking their devices with them so they can stay connected to work. And you know, eliminating that divide means that everywhere we go, there's access and we can stay connected to the broader world. We have examples like Wedco, who in their buildings, in their apartment buildings, they are providing access to free Wi-Fi and internet for their residents. They recognize like what a reality and what a just a day-to-day need it is. And then in a point, Hunts Point has created a mesh network. And so they've created digital stewards that are helping to not only build those networks, but maintain them. And so we've already seen examples of how it happens, where it can happen, where we can innovate. That's what we want to also happen here at the Gigabit Center, a place of innovation that we can expand opportunities across the borough. We'd be happy for folks to join us, be a part of the conversation, and help us decide how to expand tech equity across the borough. I know there are more voices, I know there are more thoughts around it, and we'd really love to hear them.
In urban neighborhoods like ours, decades of racist policies and practices have taken an incalculable toll. The Bronx is the United States' poorest county per capita. It is arguably the major community in America by size and scale most impacted by systemic racism. But this diverse community has the power of change within. It's time we build our levers of control, starting in the Bronx through a unique community-powerful framework for participatory philanthropy. The Bronx Community Foundation offers a model that is unique in its focus on a common agenda. We use collective impact models and assessment methods to meet shared outcomes in four pillars of sustainability. When one is missing, the structure collapses. When all four are in place, the community thrives. Our work is driven by captains, community members with area expertise. We connect these Bronx leaders with local academic institutions in a four-step community power framework for meaningful change. When COVID-19 struck, we tested our model. It works. Moving forward, we would measure and codify our program impact. We will prove our model for equitable urban renewal and share it so that communities everywhere can thrive.
Thank you to the Bronx Digital Equity Coalition for sharing more about their work and the Bronx Gigabit Center. We're taking a quick break, but don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with more Leaders of the Future.
Bronx Borough President Ruben Diaz Jr., along with community organizations, Bronx elected officials, and families, held a press conference to address tech equity in front of the New York City Department of Education, located at 1 Fordham Plaza.
We've been talking about this for a while, for many, many years. Back in March, the DOE and the chancellor said that every child would have a device, and here we are in October. And while other parts of the city are getting what they deserve, the Bronx still lags behind. We've already had our educational issues prior to the pandemic. And if the mayor truly feels like Black Lives Matter and Latino Lives Matter, then painting it on the street is not enough. Get to your job and help us make sure that we can provide both safety and a quality education for all of our students.
The Bronx BP's office states that in a survey to Bronx families, only 84,000 students out of 200,000 students in the Bronx receive devices for remote learning.
We're not a priority. We have to fight to survive things. If we're not risking something, we're sacrificing something else. Why is it always a give and take situation when it comes to low-income communities?
Recently, a story in the Daily News revealed that parents, including a South Bronx mother, are being threatened with having child services notified if their child's virtual absences continued, despite having no devices, faulty devices, and unreliable internet.
Parents have been saying since the spring that this was happening. The DOE committed to not using ACS as a weapon against our parents. But here we are, 9 months into this pandemic, and we're still dealing with the same thing.
Community organizations like the Point CDC, the Bronx Community Foundation, and others have stepped up and answered the call by providing tech resources to Bronxites. However, they stress that the Bronx needs more support and organizations can't do it alone.
Since 2017, we've been building a mesh network that allows at least 600 individuals a month to get free access to the internet. Again, this is done, again, through the generous support of the elected officials and some other philanthropic organizations, but we can't continue to keep waiting for people to do stuff, and we can't continue to keep plugging, again, into systems that don't really care for our families.
You know, we've seen different pockets of great ideas, but the entire community needs to come together to really solve a challenge that no single organization can solve. And so our focus is to ensure that every student, every parent, every Bronxite has access to the resources they need to bring themselves into the 21st century.
I feel like we've always been ignored. Like, even before the pandemic, no one's asking students how they feel. And that, it's not even about that parents can't be included in these conversations. It's that there are barriers in the way, whether it's language, whether it's a lack of understanding, that they're not being able to be included in those conversations because they just can't, you know? And I feel like we have a lot to say. We just need the right people to listen to us, and not just listen, but hear us, you know?
The borough president, Bronx families, and organizations now call for transparency from the Department of Education. They demanded an immediate sign of commitment to distribute devices, tech assistance, and access to reliable Wi-Fi for all students here in the Bronx. Reporting for BronxNet, Sanji Lopez.
Hello, and thanks for staying with us on Leaders of the Future. Agriculture and technology is a growing sector even in urban communities like here in the Bronx. And an organization called the Urban Wild runs a program to teach us all about it and more.
We're now happy to be joined by Samia Lemfadli. Samia is the CEO and founder of Urban Wild. Welcome. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
What is the Urban Wild and what is your mission?
So the Urban Wild is a Bronx-based nonprofit dedicated to making sustainable agricultural technologies more accessible to communities that are affected by food insecurity.
What is ag tech?
Ag tech is how we use technology to improve agriculture systems. So essentially how we grow our food or how we grow our agriculture throughout the country can be improved using simple technology tools like sensors, drones, or even 3D modeling to improve how we design our food systems.
Can you tell us more about Urban Wild's free job program and how it can help?
Absolutely. So Intro to Ag Tech is our free job training program. It's 150 hours over the course of 10 weeks that introduces young adult job seekers to skills in agriculture, technology, and construction. So during our course, you'll actually learn how to design, build, and maintain a smart farm system completely from start to finish, utilizing methods like hydroponics, aquaponics, aeroponics, or even mushroom growing. So sustainable, soilless farming methods that you can then have access to grow food in your own home. So we're actually providing all of our participants with up to $750 toward the build and maintenance costs of their own home farm system. We're integrating technology systems into our farm systems and introducing our students in basic skills in coding and programming so that they can then enter into fields in agriculture, technology, or construction.
How can community farms function in urban areas like the Bronx?
So community farms in the Bronx, it's definitely tricky. There's definitely different ways to utilize the space that you have either within your home using vertical growing or hydroponic farming. But what I would recommend is for folks that want to engage in more farming practices locally or urban farming, try to get your neighbors together and organize for a green roof in your building, which will have enormous impacts on emissions, on improving the ability to have wastewater management in your neighborhood and have access to growing food locally. You can also explore growing food within your schools or community gardens, but those are some of the best ways to get started.
How will this program, as well as the free job training, help all of us with the food crisis?
So as far as the food crisis, we need to look at how we're designing and building and maintaining and distributing our food systems as a whole. So part of that means that we want to equip people that have typically struggled with access to healthy, nutritious, accessible, and affordable food to have the skills to build their own systems, whether that's small-scale systems in their homes that they can then feed themselves, feed their families with, or even their communities, or larger-scale systems like the ones that we build with community gardens, with schools, with CBOs. So hopefully those systems will create more of an emphasis around free food systems being made for individuals and communities that are battling food insecurity, but more so to have individuals start to understand what can I do to redesign food systems and how I interact with them? How can I have more agency within them, more understanding of them, or even more equity within them, meaning I have ownership of farm systems or green spaces that I can use however I'd like to. And I believe that if we're utilizing sustainable farming practices, that we're setting up a model for what we're going to do to address food insecurity at a larger scale, especially as the climate crisis continues to impact agriculture.
Where can we find more details about the Urban Wild programs and benefits?
Yeah, so you can visit our website, changefoodforgood.org, or you can go to our Instagram or Facebook or LinkedIn page at changefoodforgood. We have tons of content on there teaching folks about what we do, how we do it, and what you can do to get involved in ag tech.
What got you started in wanting to do this, or what inspired you?
So a few things. Actually, I wanted to learn about technology and find solutions for just issues that I grew up with, born and raised in Brooklyn, New York, to a single parent household. I experienced a lot of issues with poverty and food insecurity. And so I felt that technology was a resource and a tool that could address things at a scalable level. So I ended up going through a workforce development bootcamp myself to learn how to code. And I had zero experience prior to going into the program and found ways that I could solve problems for people that I knew or in my life particularly. So then went on to work for nonprofits and realized that there's ways that we can leverage these skills for other people to have really great careers and also to solve the problems that we're experiencing with the climate crisis. And so that's basically how I got started.
Do you have any advice or message to the youth that you would like to share?
Absolutely, yeah. Definitely things are really difficult right now. Everyone's feeling a lot of anxiety about the future, and particularly young people. What I would say is a few things. One, find a study or a skill that you're really passionate about and go full force for it. Utilize that skill as much as you can to help yourself, help others, help your community, and try to really be a part of the change that you want to see in your community. But also just remember you're not alone. We're all in this really kind of ever-changing situation, and it's evolving very quickly every day, whether we're talking about the climate crisis or economic factors. We really need to lean on each other to be able to build the future that we want, and it's definitely possible, but not if we don't stick together. So lean on each other.
Thank you for the amazing message and just the story that we heard today. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited. I hope that wherever you go, you remember the lessons that we learned together about using your instinct, using your intuition to guide your efforts. That you leverage every single tool at your disposal, including your five senses, to fill out your environment.
It was a day to celebrate in the gardens for the newly graduates for the Agriculture Technology Program at the Urban Wild.
We just wrapped up our Intro to Ag Tech program. It's a 10-week job training course that's free of charge for youth that are either job seeking or underemployed. And so we basically educated them in the skills needed to build out sustainable farm systems like hydroponics, aquaponics, aeroponics. They actually built out their own farm system for food relief in the community garden that we're in right now, El Coqui in the Bronx.
The Bronx has one of the highest rates of food insecurity in the United States, 37% compared with 16.6 for New York City as a whole. In order to address this issue in our community, the Urban Wild seeks to make sustainable agriculture technology more accessible through their free training programs.
I'm really excited to go on and do more things on my own projects that I've been just dreaming about. And it was so great meeting people that are going to support those goals and just giving me the tools that I need to feel confident to do that.
What this program means to me is just so vital for both myself, the community, and the planet, because the way that the ecology is degrading and that we as a species aren't paying attention to it is ridiculous.
The summer 2021 graduating class has gained technology, carpentry, and additional beneficial skills that will pathway them to job opportunities in the weeks ahead.
Some of the people here have experience. Me personally, I don't, so I'm learning something new every day. All I know is that I want to help the human species because I'm part of the human species, and it takes a village to raise a single child, so imagine an entire planet. So all I know is that I want to be of service.
For more information on their ag tech program and the organization, visit changefoodforgood.org. Reporting for BronxNet, Ashley Tiffany.
That's all for our show today. Thank you for tuning in. To learn more about Niño de la Caridad Foundation, visit us at niñodelacaridad.com.
Also follow us at Niño de la Caridad Foundation on social media. We look forward to seeing you next time here on Leaders of the Future.